What's up, guys? This is Zach with Toptic Nation, and today we're going to be looking at another breakthrough on standard format list, and that is going to be VikaVault featuring Topabulu GX. Now, I believe we just did a pre-rotation list for this deck just a month or two ago, so check that out if you want to. But today we're going to be looking at a post-rotation list, and I thought it would be fitting since there are a couple of notable changes to the deck. We are seeing a lot of popular cards like Versus Seeker, Trainer's Mel, Hex Maniac rotate out, so I thought I would kind of give you my take on this deck list going forward. And I've actually seen a lot of hype for the deck. I've seen a few other YouTubers cover the deck, kind of talk about it. A lot of interesting insights shared there. And I think the deck is really, really, really strong going forward because Hex Maniac is actually rotating. It was in Ancient Origins, so it did miss the cut just by one set. And because of that, a lot of these decks that feature, you know, really ability-reliant strategies like VikaVault, Volcanion, Greninja, those decks actually get a lot stronger. So I'm actually hoping they'll reprint Hex Maniac in the near future. I think it'll happen, but it's really hard to tell because I think it kind of balances the format out. Otherwise, you have Gardevoir and some other decks that are just really, really powerful. But with that aside, I do want to kind of talk about this deck, which I think is probably in the top three contenders for the next format. If you don't know what this deck does, if you're not really familiar with it, if you're new to the card game, we have VikaVault. And VikaVault is really what makes the deck work. VikaVault is a stage 2, so it will take a little bit of effort to get it out. That's why it's a little bit balanced. But this ability Strong Charge is just really powerful. And it says once during your turn, you may search your deck for a grass energy and a lightning energy and attach it to your Pokemon in any way you like. So that means you can put both of those energy on one Pokemon, like Topabulu, for instance. We can spread those energy around if you want the grass on Topabulu, maybe the lightning on top of Coco, for example. But VikaVault is really versatile in a deck where your attackers only need like two or three energy. If you've seen the Emboar or Blastoise from a few years ago, basically the same concept, except stronger in some ways that you actually can get the energy from the deck, but also balanced in that you can't just attach as many energy as you want, just a couple energy. It's also got Electrocannon doing 150 damage. I have to discard 3 energy, but not a big deal when you can just reattach it the following turn, and then add a Choice Band, and suddenly you're hitting for that magic number of 180 to knock out most of those EXs and GXs. So VikaVault is a pretty solid second attacker, but its primary function, of course, is going to be energy acceleration. And you might be wondering, well, what is it actually accelerating to? And that is going to be Topabulu GX. That's going to be your main attacker of the deck. It has 3 really good attacks. Notice that it doesn't have weakness, which is pretty cool. I think all the Tapus are that way. So Tapu Koko, Tapu Fini, Tapu Lele, none of them have weakness. And I think that makes them really strong. Otherwise, this deck would probably lose to Volcanion pretty hard. But it actually is a pretty solid matchup thanks to not having the weakness. So we have 3 attacks here. Horn Attack is just doing a solid 30 damage for 1 energy, so that would be doing 60 with a Choice Band, or with Professor Kukui and a Choice Band, 80 for 1 energy. So definitely not shabby. You could knock out something like a Froakie with 1 hit, anything that's weak to grass. Nature's Judgment is going to be the main attack here, 120 damage, and you can actually discard all the energy on the Pokemon and it does 60 more. So this is really how we're going to be knocking out these big heavy hitting EXs and GXs. With a Choice Band, we're actually doing 210 damage, and with Kukui added to that, we're doing 230. So that's actually enough to knock out a Gardevoir GX in one hit, and this is how we are going to be countering Gardevoir throughout the game. We have Choice Band, we have Professor Kukui, we have the baby Tapu Koko promo to kind of spread damage and kind of set up those knockouts, and that's how we're going to be taking KOs throughout the game. And then finally, the GX attack is actually nothing to laugh at. I mean, 150 damage, and you heal all damage from Topabulu. So again, with a Choice Band, maybe you take a cheap knockout on like a Lele or something else they have attacking a Volcanion, and then you actually heal all of that damage. So in general, Topabulu is incredibly strong with this deck. We're also playing a copy of Orangaroo, and Orangaroo has this Instruct ability. It says you can draw until you have 3 cards in your hand, which may not sound like much, but it is a basic, so we can use Bridget on the first turn to get it out, and basically in a pinch, anytime we need to draw those cards, we can do that. We just have to thin our hand out, if we need a certain card, like a choice band or an extra energy or something, hopefully we can, you know, draw a couple cards off of that, maybe three cards, and get what we need. Rangaroo's also a pretty decent secondary attacker because it's doing 60 damage and then 20 more for each energy on your opponent's active. So also a pretty soft Gardevoir counter in that regard. We're also playing a copy of Tapu Koko. Again, that's really there because of the free retreat. There's some obvious synergy there with Guzma. You can Guzma something out, bring up the Tapu Koko, and then retreat into the attacker you had before. And of course, Flying Flip is spreading that 20 damage everywhere and setting up knockouts, especially against things like Metagross, Gardevoir GX, anything with a lot of HP. So Galio, for example. And then concluding the Pokemon list here, we play two copies of Tapu Lele. So if you've seen my other post rotation videos, I was kind of on that side that said that three Tapu Lele was the way to go. You know, if you can afford that, I would recommend it. Maybe you could drop something in this deck, but I think two definitely suffices if you're playing thick consistency cards. And as you can see, we're playing a lot of supporters here, and I'll kind of segue into that. We're playing four Sycamore, four N, so those are your standard draw counts. To Professor Kukui, just because we don't want to have to discard those. That's really critical against something like Gardevoir GX or any of these big heavy hitting stage 2 GXs. So that really just kind of makes the math perfect, especially if you can Tapu Lele and search it out and you already have the choice band. So I do like Professor Kukui in here. We're also playing a copy of Skyla. That's really good because we're playing a lot of really vital item cards like Rare Candy and Heavy Ball. Choice band, a lot of things that if we can search them out really quickly using Tapu Lele, can assure that we get that turn 2 Vikavolt and we take those knockouts really early on in the game. And finally, we're playing three copies of Guzma. I think three copies is going to be pretty standard looking ahead. Two or one was probably the norm since Versus Seeker was legal. You could easily get it into the discard and just reuse it as many times as needed. But now I think that's really just kind of a luxury. You can't really afford to keep discarding supporters. You're probably going to be playing in a lot more, just to kind of shuffle them in and kind of play more conservatively. But I think three Guzmas is the way to go, especially to make sure that Vikavolt or a Rangaroo or something doesn't get trapped in the active. And then finally, Bridget, of course, just to kind of search out our Pokemon in the first couple turns of the game. Ideally, you either want Bridget in your hand or you can Wonder Tag with Tapu Lele to get it out. But we want to make sure we have a couple of Grubbins so they don't get knocked out and Tapu Bulu. So if you already have a Grubbin out, you could definitely get like two Tapu Bulu and a Rangaroo, any kind of combination. It really just kind of depends on your opening hand. But in general, Bridget is just incredibly strong and you're going to be seeing that card in pretty much every deck. Now, as far as our items go, we're playing a pretty scattered count of stuff here. We're playing four Ultra Ball and four Rare Candy just to make sure that we are going for that turn one Bridget and the turn two Vikavolt. That's really critical to the deck. If you're not getting Vikavolt out, you're in some serious trouble because you have to manually attach that Tapu Bulu, and taking three or four turns to kind of burn through your deck and attach, you know, it's probably going to get Guzman out and knocked out really quickly. So it's really important that we maximize those counts. We're also playing three choice band. Again, we want to draw into that pretty quickly so that we can attach it to the Tapu Bulu and get those knockouts. Two float stone, just because Vikavolt and a Rangaroo are kind of like targets. If you if they Guzma them out, they're kind of stuck in the active position. Something like Greninja, for example. We want to make sure that we can retreat really quickly and take those really quick knockouts. We're also going to be playing a couple copies of Energy Recycler as well as a Rescue Stretcher. Now, there is a bit of debate on what kind of counts you should run as far as Energy Recycler, Super Rod, Rescue Stretcher. In general, I think Energy Recycler is just too good not to play in this deck. Super Rod is okay just because it's a little more versatile. It can put Pokemon on the deck as well. But in this deck, you're going to be quickly discarding your energies. We need to get those back. Fisherman isn't really a great way just because it puts those in your hand. Brock's Grit's also not quite as good anymore because you can't really reuse it with Versus Seeker. So if you discard it, it's pretty much gone. So we are playing a couple copies of Energy Recycler to make sure that we can always fuel that strong charge ability. And what I like about Rescue Stretcher is that it has dual benefits here. You can shuffle Pokemon into your deck, or you can add one into your hand. So if you have to discard your Vikavolts early, or they play Parallel City and get rid of some stuff, you can always get that back when you need to. We're also going to be playing a couple copies of Phil Blower, which I would recommend because it is really good against the Garbodor matchup. You don't want to have your abilities shut off by that Garbotoxin Garbodor, so it's really imperative that we can draw into it. We're already playing Skyla, so that's pretty good. Making sure that we always knock off those tool cards, and, you know, in general, against things like Choice Band, Floatstone, not just against the Garbotoxin matchup, but against anything else. I mean, Gardevoir can knock you out with a couple energy and a Choice Band if your Tapu Bulu is powered up, so it kind of makes it a little bit harder for that to happen. And finally, we're also playing a copy of Heavy Ball. I was actually on the fence about this until I tested it. I saw a lot of lists playing Heavy Ball, and I was like, I don't know if it's any good, but you have to keep in mind that it searches out your main attacker, so Tapu Bulu, as well as your main way to get energy out. So it actually searches out Vikavolt, and I believe it actually searches out, it searches out Charjabug as well. So it's searching out a good chunk of your Pokemon, a good half of your Pokemon. So you can always Skyla for the Heavy Ball if you already have the rare candy. You can Heavy Ball just in a pinch and get that Tapu Bulu or something if you need it. So I think Heavy Ball is pretty solid in here. And as far as our energy count goes, we're playing 12 energy. This seems to be the energy count most players are using. We're playing 7 grass and 5 lightning. And 7 grass mainly because this is a grass deck primarily. Tapu Bulu needs 2 grass in order to attack. So I think grass, you have to play a thicker count if that makes sense. And then 5 lightning just because there are some attackers that can take advantage of it. We have Tapu Koko, which can hit for 100 using Electro Ball if you want to kind of soften up something or 2-shot, get that prize exchange in your favor with Tapu Koko and Vikavolt. I mean, don't think that just because Vikavolt is your energy acceleration that it can't also attack. Like I said, the energy cost is a little bit high, but you can use Choice Band and get a knockout on a lot of stuff. So definitely keep that into consideration. But that is going to wrap up the list, guys. Overall, I've been testing this list, and it's been incredibly strong because I think this is probably one of the top 3 decks going forward. I mean, how do you really combat this kind of energy acceleration, this kind of aggressiveness? Tapu Bulu is taking knockouts pretty much every turn of the game, and they can't really do much. They can't really shut off your abilities unless they're playing the Garbotoxin Garbodor or Greninja. And you can just constantly attach energy. You can heal with Tapu Bulu. So there are a number of ways this deck is going to be really good going forward into this standard format. But with that said, let's jump into a game I played on PTCGO recently so you can see this deck in action and get a feel of how the strategy works. Okay, guys, looks like we are going to go ahead and get started here. So looks like my opening hand, I got a mulligan, so I'll have to reshuffle. My opponent will get an extra card. It does kind of stink that I have to start with Tapu Lele because I only play a couple of those, don't want to have to, but I do get the Bridget, so I probably would have Tapu Lele to begin with. So my opponent is going to kick off here. I see a fairy deck box, so unless he's trying to trick me here, it looks like he's probably playing a Gardevoir deck. And this deck is probably about 50-50. You know, I would probably give the edge to the Gardevoir deck because it's a little bit easier for them to set up those knockouts. So we're going to have to be a little aggressive here. So hopefully we can knock out these Ralts before they actually become Gardevoirs. Otherwise, we're going to have a little bit of trouble because he can just kind of keep piling up that energy. So I'm going to go ahead and use Bridget. Again, like I said, in the deck list itself, the deck profile, it is important that we get a couple of these Grubbin out because if something happens, like if he does get Gardevoir out and just kind of Guzmas out the Grubbin, we are going to be in some trouble. So I think it's really important that we do that. But my hand here is not too bad. I've got Floatstone just in case he tries to stall out a little bit. I put an energy on the top of Lele so that way maybe I can set up for a knockout against these Ralts. If I can charge up the Tapu Lele using Vikavolt, maybe I can do something like that. I don't really know. But we are going to see the end, and it looks like he actually ended me into a really good hand here. I've got the Guzma, I've got the Rare Candy for the Heavy Ball into the Vikavolt turn 2. And that's why this deck is just so good. If you can Rare Candy the second turn of the game, you've pretty much won a lot of games because it's kind of hard to keep up with something that's doing like 180 or 210 damage out of nowhere. So we're going to go ahead and Heavy Ball. We're going to go ahead and Rare Candy into the Vikavolt, of course. So now we can attach a couple extra energy per turn. And I'm just kind of thinking here, you know, what should I do? Should I go for a cheap knockout against the top of Lele? Because I could definitely do that. But I think the correct play, especially since he has Curlia out, that Gardevoir was definitely him coming out. I mean, he probably has a supporter in his hand. He's got the Octillery to draw extra cards. So I think the best play here was to knock out the Curlia. Now, if he decides to promote another Ralts, if he can get another Ralts out, we're going to have to keep doing this because Top of Lele isn't too much of a threat here. If it gets a ton of energy on it, like right now, you know, maybe it's a threat. I mean, I don't really know. But I think as long as he just has the one Ralts, we should just keep on using Guzma. So that's probably what I'm going to do here. He needs a choice band. If he can get a choice band, let's see, there's seven energy on the board. So no, he actually needs an energy and a choice band. So he can't take the knockout, in other words, this turn. He'll be a little bit short. So I could knock out the top of Lele again. But if you look at my hand here, I've actually got another Guzma. So my opponent using N is actually kind of backfiring on him, but we'll have to see. I mean, the later game, he could definitely get the edge here. So he's got that Abyssal hand. He's going to energy drive, and like I said, he's actually 40 damage short. If I can Vika Volt, if there are two energy in the deck, which it looks like there are, I can attach the Lele and go ahead and knock out another Curlia. So I've got the four energy on it, so I'm doing 80 damage with that energy drive attack. The Guzma is going to let me go ahead and knock out the Curlia. So right now I am in pretty fantastic shape. I mean, I've already taken a couple prizes. I mean, I think Top of Lele is probably going to be knocked out this turn because Top of Lele, his Top of Lele, I should say, has four energy on it. So it's doing 160 as it is, so a knockout. He's going to end me to four, which is kind of sad because I could have Sycamored next turn, attached an energy maybe. But I think we are in pretty good shape. Now, if he gets a couple more Ralts out, I'm probably going to be in some trouble, but we're going to have to see what happens. He's going to opt to use the Rescue Stretcher, get a couple of Ralts in the discard. So, all right, he's going to go ahead and attach. The attachment wasn't really necessary, but I'm guessing he's doing that so he can kind of thin his hand out and Abyssal Hand. So he's going to go ahead and Abyssal Hand, and we might see another Waltz come down. We do. So we see an Energy Drive. So at this point, it is a little bit scary because the prizes, we are kind of tied up as far as that goes. I don't have another Guzma, so I actually don't have another way of getting rid of the next Ralts, because I think if we did that, we would pretty much win the game. It would take him a little bit to kind of get set up. So next turn, we might be in a little bit of trouble, thinking a little ahead. I can take a couple of prizes this turn, so that might be something. The question is, what should I Skyla for? Should I go ahead and get another Vika Volt set up? I mean, I've got the Grass Energy. I've got everything I really need. But is that what I should do? Because otherwise, next turn, I'm going to have to use Kukui. I can't really draw a bunch of cards. So it's really a coin flip up in the air whether or not he gets that Gardevoir out. So I think that's probably the safe play. Basically, if I get a choice band, I would win the game because I could knock out Gardevoir. Or if I get like a Guzma or something, maybe I could knock out the top of Lele on the bench. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Energy doesn't really matter at this point. I'm going to go ahead and take a couple prizes, and it looks like I actually whiff getting a supporter. So Kukui isn't the worst thing in the world, but I really need a Sycamore or a top of Lele or something, any way to get that Sycamore. So he's going to go ahead and use a Sycamore on his own, and we're going to have to see what happens. Oh no, we see the Gardevoir come out, and he's got another Ralts on the bench as well. So Gardevoir is one of those decks where it's just super good at making comebacks because they can put you in this awkward position of where they'll end you to one or two. They've got like five or six energy on this Gardevoir. I mean, I'm not in horrible shape. And honestly, you know, if I get a choice band, I'll win the game, or a Guzma or something, but that's really asking for a lot at this point. So we're going to have to see what happens here. I'm kind of reluctant about bringing up the blue. I get an N, but N isn't really going to help me too much. It actually doesn't help. It actually doesn't hurt him at all because he can just use Abyssal Hand. And I don't have any energy in the deck. So I think I'm going to Kukui. I get the Ultra Ball, so it looks like it was on the top card of the deck or so. I'm going to Ultra Ball for the Oringaroo. I think if I can draw a couple cards out of the deck, maybe I can get the Choice Band. But in hindsight, you know, maybe this was a bit of a misplay of mine. So I'm going to go ahead and attach to Oringaroo, and let's go ahead and instruct. If we get a Choice Band, we win the game, and looks like we don't get it. So this is pretty unfortunate. I'm going to have to Nature's Judgment for 180. But if he gets a few energy on Gardevoir, because I think he's already doing 90, so if he gets three more energy on the Gardevoir, we lose. But if he doesn't, we can probably win the game. But there's the DCE, and he's probably going to be able to use Abyssal Hand, use a supporter, so we've probably lost, unfortunately. You know, maybe it was a misplay on my part. Maybe I should have tried to attack with the Grubbin somehow if I could have. Maybe that one turn I should have Skyled for the Sycamore. Really hard to say. More access to cards definitely would have helped out. But as you can see, the matchup was extremely close. I was pretty aggressive early on. But like I said, Gardevoir is just so good in the late game. Even if you end them, they just Abyssal Hand with Octillery. So yeah, that pretty much wraps up this video, guys. And I would have liked to have won that game, but you could definitely see the overall strategy of the deck, how to set up, and how powerful it is once it is set up. So I'm glad you guys were able to see that. But let me know in the comments what you guys want to see in the future, what kind of decks featuring the Breakthrough on standard format, as well as the Black and White on expanded format. We're also going to be covering some retro decks in the near future, so let me know if you guys are excited for that. But yeah, that should pretty much wrap things up, guys. This has been Zach with Top Deck Nation. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll catch you in the next video tomorrow.